Shall we open our Bible in the book of John, chapter 11, verses 25 to 26? John chapter 11, verses 25 to 26. It says, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? God bless the reading of His word.
Shout, 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 for the hope we find, for the feeling is real. thanks to you, Lord. Man, we want to bless you. We want to say thank you for all you have done in our life. Glory to your name. Glory to your name, Lord. All the blessing comes upon our life. Just one thing that I cannot see. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All of you have given to me. All of the blessing that I cannot see. I bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, thank you, Lord, for what you've done.
My darkness and give me your light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You took my sin and my fear. You took my sickness and healed all my pain.
I just want to thank you. Pierce the night, and I will rise.
the word and also the scripture we need. That today, Lord, your word will just pierce into hearts and touch lives. Pray all this in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son,
on a hill called Calvary. There stands an endless mercy tree. Every broken, weary soul, find your rest and be made whole. Stripes of blood that stain its frame, shed to wash away our shame. From the skies pure love released, salvation by the mercy tree. mercy tree.
Easter and Resurrection Sunday greetings to you. It looks like I have to quote the Apostle Paul's words to the church in Corinth. I am not with you in person, but in truth. The church is moving into unseen new territory, going into cyberspace. You know, as the saying goes, necessity is the mother of invention. On a serious note, in the midst of what's going on around the world, it seems like we are racing to an uncertain future. There are ways people handle with uncertainties. There's worry, despair, complain, wait and see, or continue to put our trust in God. We shouldn't be surprised at this end times, nor should we be too anxious. God is still seated on his throne, and Jesus is still seated at his right hand, interceding for us. What's at stake, really, is the condition of our soul. Are we ready to see Jesus? Easter is a great time for the church to reevaluate our focus. And that focus should be that our hope, that our eternity can only be found in the person of Jesus Christ. He is the author and finisher of our faith. And many listening to this already have Jesus as the author of our faith. But will he be the finisher of your faith as well? Jesus came, lived amongst men, and completed the mission he was sent for. That mission was to live a sinless life and to lay down his life as the perfect sacrifice for the sins of the world. Easter Sunday is a reminder that Christ rose from the grave, defeated sin and death. Let me quote the words from Billy Graham. He says this: "For the believer, there is hope beyond the grave, because Jesus Christ has opened the door to heaven for us by his death and resurrection. Easter always brings hope to all of us. For the Christian, the cross tells us that God understands our suffering. For he took upon himself at the cross all our sins and all our failures and all of our sufferings." What great words from the late Billy Graham. What a man of God. Our hope can only be true if the object of our hope is true. Let me repeat that. Our hope can only be true if the object of our hope is true. Many without God place their hopes and future on what they thought would last, and then realize that their trust in such things can't last through the fires of testings and trials, especially during this MCO period. James chapter 1 verse 11, I hope you have your Bible app open or your physical Bible open. Turn to James chapter 1 verse 11. It says this: "For no sooner has the sun risen with a burning heat than it withers the grass, its flowers falls, and its beautiful appearance perishes. So the rich man also will fade away in his pursuits." Let me read that again. "For no sooner has the sun risen with a burning heat than it withers the grass, its flowers, its flower falls, and its beautiful appearance perishes. So the rich man also will fade away in his pursuits." You know, it reminds me, especially in Malaysian weather, when we have our rainy season, you know, the grass grows very quickly, and then during the drought season towards the first quarter of the year, you look at the grass, they turn brownish and dull, dry, brownish and dull. And so this passage from James is so true about the grass, that, you know, under the burning heat, the grass withers and the flower loses its beautiful appearance. And it says that the rich man also will fade away in his pursuits. Jesus Christ alone is the hope of all men, the Lord and Savior. There are over 300 prophecies about Jesus in the Old Testament. 300 prophecies about Christ or the Messiah, all fulfilled during the life of Christ. From the creation of Adam to the birth of Jesus, that's 4,000 years. Okay? Not 3 or 30 prophecies, but 300. The mathematical probability of Jesus fulfilling even a handful is not only improbable, but impossible. There's one professor at Pasadena College, his name is Peter Stoner. He's the chairman of the Department of Mathematics and Astronomy. He took 600 Christian students to analyze 8 prophecies about Jesus. For each one being fulfilled, and the conclusion was this, 8 prophecies, all right, out of 300. The probability that all 8 prophecies would be fulfilled was 1 in 10 to the power of 17. Let me say that, 1 in 10 to the power of 17. 17 zeros after, 17 zeros. It's like, what he says is like taking silver dollars, it's equivalent maybe to our 50 cent coin, Malaysian coin, covering all over the state of Texas. Now for reference sake, the size of Malaysia, Peninsula and Sabah and Sarawak, it's about 330 square kilometers. Texas is twice the size of that. Now just imagine that. Cover the whole state of Texas 2 feet deep, not just on the surface, but 2 feet deep, and then telling a man to walk anywhere in Texas and find one coin that represent all 8 prophecies fulfilled. If you double that to 16 prophecies, the statistics are 10 to the power of 45. 45 zeros. This Easter bears such significance because it is also Passover week. For those who don't know, Passover is the celebration of the deliverance of the Jewish people by God from their bondage in Egypt under the guidance of Moses. The proud, stubborn Pharaoh who thought that he was greater than the God of Moses, he refused to release God's people from slavery. God sent plague after plague at each of Pharaoh's refusal. The final plague was the angel of death, which killed all the firstborn Egyptians. But God's people were spared because they applied the blood of a lamb upon their doors. Easter is a fulfillment of Passover. Passover was about sin and death. Every Israelite firstborn would also die along with the Egyptians. But their deliverance was the sacrificial blood of a lamb applied over the door. 1400 years later, Easter proclaims God's total victory over sin and death, evidenced by the death and resurrection of Christ from the grave 3 days after. John chapter 14 verse 6, the words of Jesus, John 14 verse 6, I am the way, the truth and the life. No one can come to the Father, meaning heaven, except through me. You know, these are outrageous words if we think logically. No man, no founder of any religion has made that kind of outrageous claim to be the only way to heaven. I mean, how significant can you get? Some may say prophetic at a time like this where the world is going through turmoil, that the message about God's deliverance and salvation is more significant than ever. There is a spirit of death going on all over the world, like during Moses' time. And the message of deliverance and hope couldn't be more timely. Jesus' blood must cover our hearts, His thought over our minds, and His will over ours. It is significant also in that when someone dies without knowing Christ, the suffering, the torment of the soul in hell is far, far greater than the present state. You may be listening to this and have friends or loved ones infected with the COVID virus, or you may have lost people. You may have lost them. Or you may be the one infected with it, and you're listening to this. Recognize that our life on earth is temporary. We are just passing through. The Bible calls us pilgrims, sojourners. But also know this, if God has already determined that your time on earth is up, no man can stop that. When death comes knocking on your door, you can't say, wait, give me 5 minutes, let me put on my makeup, I want to look my best. But if God has determined that you live, you will live. We live in a world of suffering and pain simply because sin exists in this world. Jesus came and identified himself with us through his suffering. Paul offers comforting words. He himself went through much suffering and persecution for the Lord. And he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 to 18, therefore, we do not lose hope. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at these things, at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For all things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Here Paul reminds us that everything will perish. Everything that we have, everything that we own, our lives, our trials, but they are only temporary. Jesus Christ, through his death and resurrection, gives us hope. That which we see with our eyes, that which we feel with our flesh, but the life that Jesus gives is eternal. What we see, what we feel are temporary, but the life that Jesus gives is eternal. And I want to close with this. At Calvary, two thieves were also crucified alongside Jesus. You might say that Jesus in the middle, always when we see the picture of Calvary, we see three crosses and Jesus is in the middle. So you might say that Jesus in the middle is the focus and the two thieves, you and I. One insulted him and said, if you are the Messiah, save yourself and us. The other thief said, don't you fear God? We will get what our deeds deserve. And then he turned to Jesus and said this, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus answered this thief, today you will be with me in paradise. Today you will be with me in paradise. Just imagine a thief hanging on the cross, appealing to Jesus, give me eternity, give me eternal life. What did he do to accomplish eternal life? Except just ask Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. They were words of repentance, and Jesus said to him, today you will be with me in paradise. The responses of these two sinners reflect how the world responds to the gospel. They either reject him, they either reject the gospel, they despise the message, or they look to Jesus as their eternal hope. At the time of recording this message, you know, the MCO will live in 2 days when you're hearing this. On Sunday, or it could be extended. No, this pandemic is temporary, but the future of your soul isn't. The destiny of your soul is eternal. My question to you is this, Who or what do you place your hope in right now? Who or what do you place your hope in? If you are listening to this message and you are not sure of where your hope lies, where your eternal destiny lies, or maybe you're a Christian and you are in need of forgiveness for your sins, listen, Jesus' death on the cross has made God's forgiveness available. His blood is able to cleanse us from all sins. Only by believing in Jesus, by confessing Him as your Lord and Savior, can you be sure of your eternal destiny. Jesus says, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die." Jesus' blood rewrites your history. His blood covers your destiny. If you need Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life today, right now, or if you are a Christian and you need forgiveness for your sins, would you close your eyes and pray this prayer along with me? Lord Jesus, I confess my sins. I confess that I have sinned against you. Jesus, forgive me. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. Father, I have rebelled against you. Forgive me for turning my heart away from you. Right now, I receive you into my life. Be my God, be my Savior. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Whether you are a new Christian, if you have prayed a prayer, you are a new Christian, or you are an old Christian, trusting in Jesus means we need to read the Bible and pray. If you believe that God answers prayers, then pray. Our warfare is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and rulers in the heavenlies. Spiritual warfare can only be won in a spiritual battleground. Christ has provided the victory for us. So we need to get our minds off what we see, what we hear, but to engage our faith in prayer. Lastly, if you have need for physical healing, God heals. Isaiah 53 verse 5 says, "He was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed." Another translation says, "By his stripes, we are healed." The 39 beatings that he received just before he was crucified symbolizes that he took all our physical pain and sicknesses upon his body. If you are at home, and I hope that you are, and you are in need of healing, would you place your hand on the sick part of your body, whatever sick part of the body is, and let's pray. Let's believe that God heals. Jesus heals. In the Old Testament, he says that God, Jehovah Rapha, he's the God that heals in the book of Exodus. And today, Jesus also heals. Put your hand upon that sick part of the body, and let's claim that healing promise right now. Jesus, I pray against that pain, that infirmity, that sickness right now, in the name of Jesus. That cancer, that heart problem, that heart disease, in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray against that hypertension, God, that whatever problems that these people who are listening in may have, God. They are taking medication, long-term medication for their sicknesses. In the name of Jesus, God, I rebuke that sickness. Right now, I rebuke that pain. I rebuke that infirmity in the name of Jesus. I speak healing and I release an anointing of healing upon my brothers and sisters and the children who are listening in. For you have said, God, in your word, I am the God that healeth thee. Thank you, Jesus, for that healing. Take away every sickness and pain right now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, before I close, I want to say this. If you have prayed to receive Jesus if you have prayed to receive forgiveness for your sins, or you have received healing today, if God has touched you physically, would you write a note to your church or to your pastor and testify what Jesus has done for you? With this, I want to say, God bless you for watching.
We are so thankful for Easter Sunday, telling us about the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's alive and alive forevermore. Because of his resurrection, you and I can have life and life to the fullness. You know, one form of worship is giving. It's a privilege to give to God as an act of worship. I'd like to read a portion of scripture to you, taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, telling us about the generosity and the sacrificial giving of the Church of Jesus Christ in supporting, in providing for the needs of the church and the people. It says here in verse 1, "And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people, and they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us. So we urge Titus, just as he had earlier made a beginning, to bring also to completion this act of grace on your part. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving." What an encouragement, seeing the generosity of the people, and it's a sacrificial giving. I believe at moments like this in our times of crisis, I think all the more we need to trust God, not receiving all the time, but believe God is challenging us to give to Him, to put Him first in our life. So giving is an act of worship. It's a privilege to give to God and to trust that He will provide for all our needs. Maybe amongst us, there are some who are in financial need and would like to remember you in prayer. We want to encourage you to always look to God because He is our provider. And as we pray, I want you to continue to trust God, that God is going to provide. God is going to provide even for all of us and even for the Church of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Our precious Heavenly Father, it is always a joy when it comes to giving. Your word has said that, God, you love a cheerful giver. And during this time of crisis, there are some who are in financial need, and we pray in Jesus' name that you will provide for them, provide for the family. Even as we give to you, dear God, we want to believe and trust in your goodness, that indeed you will never forsake us, you will never leave us. The Lord, we give because we love you. We give because indeed we desire with all our hearts to worship you, that we want to place you first, that indeed you are first in each one of our lives. Lord, we are so thankful for such a privilege that we can give to you. Bless everyone who gives, dear God. And for those who are unable, we pray that God, you will provide for them. We pray that God, that you will continue to even bring about the need and also the help. So thank you, Lord God, giving us this opportunity. Pour out your abundance, pour out, Lord, your blessings, and pour out your provision in Jesus' name.